To list the shows our castaways appeared in is to catalogue the great Western musical hits of the past 20 years. She made her debut in the chorus of Hair, followed it with Jesus Christ Superstar, and played her first leading role in Grease. She scored a great personal success in Billy, opposite Michael Crawford, and followed this with the role that made her an international star, Eva Perón, in Evita. Then came Cats, followed by the lead in the hit musical Chess, and she is Elaine Paige. Elaine, as I said in the introduction there, I mean, all those are parts that any other actress would die for. Has it been luck or good management, do you think?
I think, I have to say, luck, probably, and a lot of hard work and just a matter of persevering, really, because very early on in my career I found that I would go up for auditions and I always managed somehow or other to get down to the last two or three. Inevitably, I would then get the big elbow and somehow didn't seem to quite get the job. I mean, a lot of those that you've mentioned, or the early ones anyway, were very much chorus.
Yes, but nonetheless you're in them, and nonetheless they had a significant part in the development of
musical theatre. Oh, absolutely, yes. You can't start at the top. I mean, you've got to learn, and that's how I learnt, really, through being in the shows rather than at drama school, although I was at drama school for 3 years.
And what about the music that you've chosen to accompany on this island? Are they all memories or...?
Yes, memories from different various times in my life, yeah.
What about the first choice, then? What's that a memory of?
Well, the Hallelujah Chorus reminds me of my school days, and in fact it was the first ever public performance that I gave with the Southall Girls' Choir, and it reminds me of music lessons whereby whenever we had music lessons we would go in and we'd have to learn several more bars of this, what I consider to be quite a difficult piece. And it just reminds me that it's the one and only time also that I've ever sung with a lot of voices, and there's something quite gratifying about being able to learn your own harmony line, your own part, and hold your own when all around you is singing something totally different. So it reminds me of those days.
Yeah.
what kind of background did you come from? What did your parents do? Was there any showbiz in the family?
Well, only in an amateur way, really. My father plays the drums, and my mother has sung. They both were involved in concert party during the war. So in that sense, there's theatre and music in the family. But by profession, my father was an estate agent and my mother is a milliner.
So where do you get your ambitions from then? Because one assumes, looking at your career, that you had an ambition from a very early age.
Well, I don't know that I did, really. I mean, it was something that my family and I both together seemed to discover, really. No, it wasn't an ambition that I had very early on. In fact, the one ambition I had, I wanted to be a tennis player. That's what I remember quite clearly. And, of course, the headmistress at my school said to me, well, that's hopeless, Elaine, because you're far too small, you can't see over the net. And she was actually absolutely quite right about that. But I didn't see why that should stop me being a great tennis player. But
so how did stage school come into it then?
Well, it was really from my secondary school, Southall. My music teacher would get us to perform Hallelujah Chorus, or we did a potted version of Mozart, Magic Flute. So I think it really came from that, really, from just doing these end-of-term plays and musical recitals and so on, like any school child does, I suppose. But I seem to remember wanting to do that far more than the academic studies that one was required to do at school, and so I would sort of make up all kinds of reasons and stories to get out of the class that I should be in, to go and, you know, sit at the piano in the assembly hall and rehearse.
Another choice of record.
Well, this one is a song from West Side Story, which I suppose was my first introduction to musical theatre. It's one of those musicals where all the elements seem to come together perfectly well. The story, the music, the lyrics, the style of the piece. And so I've chosen Barbara Streisand to sing her version of Something's Coming.
I suppose it was from, stage school that you went for your very first audition?
Oh, yes.
And how old were you then?
I should think 16. I hadn't been there very long, in fact, only a matter of months when I went for my first audition. I will remember that till my dying day.
Why is that?
Well, I'd learnt this song, I'm Just a Girl Who Can't Say No, and I thought I knew the lyric perfectly well. And I got to the audition and they called my name, and that was a whole hoo-ha. He's trying to spell my name and explain who I was.
We should say here, because your name wasn't Paige at that time.
No,
was it?
It's my real name is Bickerstaff, and you can see why I changed it, because every time I went out, we'd go through this rigmarole of spelling it, and could you say that again? Has it got an E on the end? Oh, it was that used to take up 5 minutes of their time. And So I get to the audition, we go through all that business with the name, and then they ask me what I'm going to sing, and I tell them I'm just a girl who can't say no. And I start off terribly well. I remember about the first four lines, and then there was this terrible blank in my brain. It was like I suddenly didn't have a brain at all, and just nothing. And I found myself just kind of going da-di-da-di-da, la-di-da, and I felt such a fool. But I didn't stop. I just kept on going la-di-da-di-da. And in the end, they said, thank you, thank you. And that was the first time I ever heard that sort of chorus over from the darkness of the theatre. And, of course, I realised that nerves do very strange things to you, and that you have to learn a song, I have to learn anything, really, really, even more than you think you need to.
Another choice of record, please.
Well, this one is the Everly Brothers, and it reminds me of a time in my life when I suppose I was just becoming aware of pop music, really. And a girlfriend and I tried to learn this song, and again, I sang the harmony part and she sang the lead line, and we used to bore our friends and our parents with our rendition of All I Have to Do Is Dream.
Dream. Charms, whenever I want you, all I have to do is dream. Dream, dream, dream when I feel blue in the night and I need you to hold me tight. Whenever I want you, all I have to do is dream. I can make you mine, taste your lips of wine, anytime, night or day. Only trouble is, gee whiz, I'm dreaming my life away. I need you so, that I could die. I love you so, and that is why. Whenever I want you, all I have to do is dream.
You made your West End debut in 1968 in Hair. What do you remember of that time and of that musical? Were they good days?
Oh, yes. I'd go as far as to say it's probably one of the happiest times in my life. I was young, I was only 18 years old, and a hippie, of course.
You were a hippie, were you?
Oh, yes, very much so, to my mother's disbelief. I look back fondly at that time because it was a time of sort of freedom and a very positive time for young people. We all had, there was a job to be had, we all had money. And as you say, I was in my first West End show, Hair, and it was just, I don't know, probably I'm being a bit romantic about it, but it was a wonderful time, I remember. I lived in a commune in Hampstead. And then we all at one point decided that we were going to leave there and go down and live in the country and grow our own vegetables, which was quite horrendous. That never worked at all. I mean, it was all these wonderful ideals, but trying to put it all into practice was really another matter altogether.
But it was a rather silly time too, wasn't it? I've always think when I see sort of the newsreels of that time, because I lived through it too, but essentially silly it was. Pleasant, but silly.
Yeah, I suppose it was a bit silly. I mean, looking back on it, it seems silly, but at the time it didn't. At the time, I remember sort of believing in the whole thing very much so, in that, you know, love and peace and to treat your fellow man with respect and care and gentleness and kindness and all that and everything that went along with it. I think that's admirable. I think it's a shame in a way that there isn't enough of it anymore. But I suppose it was a bit silly, yes, but it was harmless.
Another choice of record, please.
This is that fantastic track, Here Comes the Sun.
Mm-hmm. comes the sun, do 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 do. Here comes the sun, and I say it's all right. Little darling, it's been a long, cold, lonely winter. Little darling, it seems like years since it's been here. Here comes the sun, doo 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 doo. Here comes the sun, and I say it's all right. Smiles return into the faces. Little darling, it feels like years since it's been here. Here comes the sun, do 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 do. Here comes the sun, and I say it's all right.
You've also done straight acting as well. You, in fact, worked for a while with Joan Littlewood's Actors' Workshop at Stratford East, didn't you?
I did, yes, but I have to say that was primarily in a sort of a review-type thing, so it was sort of sketches and scenes from plays and things and singing and so on. In fact, it was one of the maddest shows I've ever been involved in. Every night there would be at either side of the Cross Arch a different running order, so it was never the same twice. She would be infuriated if you went on and came off the same way, and you know, she said, I don't care, one night if you want to swing in from the on a rope from the box you can do so, but I don't want you to do it the same ever twice. So it was a great learning time for me, because when you work in commercial theatre, obviously one is limited to a certain amount of rehearsal and a certain budget and so on and so forth. And over there, it was much freer. You were allowed to experiment a lot more, even in front of the poor paying audience. I mean, that was what she wanted. She wanted you to do it different every time you performed. And so it was a great learning process and wonderful fun.
Did you, though, at any time, I mean, you did Hair, of course, you did Jesus Christ Superstar, then you starred in Grease, and then you went into Billy with Michael Crawford, had tremendous success in all of them. Was there a sense in which you find yourself being typecast, that you thought, look, enough is enough of the musical theatre, or
yes,
something else?
Yes, very much so. That is the problem, that you start to go from one to the other to the other, and, of course, then you are known only as a musical performer in musical theatre. And of course I did begin my career as a straight actress in Birmingham, and so yes, I did very much feel that I wanted to shake that and try and get out of what it felt really rather like being in a rut. But, of course, making that choice, I put myself out of work for probably about, I don't know, the longest that I'd ever been out, which was over 6 months. But, again, it was through my own choice, so I didn't mind so much. But it was very difficult to try and get my foot back into the straight side of the profession.
Yes.
And I don't think, really, I ever achieved it. I mean, the doors were beginning to open up, of course, when Evita came along.
Well, let's have another choice of record.
Well, I wanted to play a piece of Mozart. Again, going back to my school days, it was my music teacher that introduced Mozart into my life, and I'm very grateful to her for it. And over the years, I've grown to love listening to Mozart, and indeed, I even still try and sing some of it. We used to do potted versions at school of one potted version of the Magic Flute, and occasionally at singing lessons I attempt to sing some Mozart, but I don't think this I could ever sing. It's the most wonderful aria called Queen of the Night, and I'd never tire of listening to this.
That was the Queen of the Night's aria from Act Two of Mozart's The Magic Flute, sung there by Karin Ott, with the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Herbert von Karajan. Evita, a huge influence on your life, a turning point, I mean, transformed you into a major international star. How great was the competition for Evita, to start with?
It was great in that I was told, certainly via the press, so how true it is I don't know, that there's certainly, I should think, over 400 people were seen for the role. And then, of course, the press started saying that such people as Faye Dunaway, Liza Minnelli, and they started sort of, you know, name-dropping every woman who was sort of in her 30s or whatever to play this part. So it was fairly stiff competition, that's true. And I did, I remember, 4 auditions for it and got down to the old 4 people again, and I thought, here we go. But this time I was lucky.
Did you want it very badly? I mean, obviously you did, but did you want it from the point of view that you knew that it was your part?
Yes, it was one of those things. To be honest, when my agent first suggested that I auditioned for it, I was reluctant because, as I was saying earlier, I was just about to open a few new doors in terms of straight acting, and this meant that I would be putting myself right back where I started. But, of course, once I'd heard the music and read the sort of synopsis, and I started to try and research a bit about her. I started to find out about her and Argentina and that whole era, and I became fascinated by the woman. And once that had happened, yes, then I really wanted it very badly because I felt that I could serve the piece well, because there were certain things in terms of my height, which is fairly obvious, was correct for the part. But I also felt that this was an opportunity for me to be able to put together something that I'd been in a dilemma about, which was my acting career and my music and my singing. And this was going to be able to afford me to be able to put the two things together.
You became, of course, that classic showbiz phenomena. You became the overnight success after being in the business for 10 years.
Yes.
How did you cope with that? I mean, things did change for you, didn't they?
Well, it did, yes. I mean, we do all laugh about that, but in truth, it was true that my life changed radically overnight, and it was quite difficult to handle, really, because I was very much on my own. You know, I had an agent, and that was about it. I didn't really have a personal manager or accountants or lawyers or anyone really looking after me. It was just me living off my own wits along with my agent, basically. And, of course, everybody wanted a part of me. I was offered recording contracts and, you know, adverts to advertise this, that and the other, and doing interviews. I could have done several interviews every day of the week. I was suddenly thrown into this whole lifestyle that was totally alien to me. And looking back, I wonder how I got through it without sort of cracking up.
That's another choice of record.
Well, this is a song from Lena Horne, and somebody that I've only sort of gotten to know about over the last 2 or 3 years, actually. A friend of mine asked me to go and see her at the London Palladium, and I went along really obviously knowing about her, but not knowing a great deal about her work. And she just blew me away, the most amazing live performance. And she just made me feel, oh, I might as well give up, because she just has everything. This is a great song that she sang 2 or 3 minutes, maybe 5 minutes into the opening of this act that I saw, and it's called I've Got a Name.
Like the pine tree line on a winding road, I got a name. I got a name. Like the singing bird and the croaking toad, yes, I got a name. I got a name. And I carried with me, like my daddy did, but I'm living a dream that he kept hid. Yes, and it's his dream that keeps me free, like a north wind whistling down the sky. I got a song. Song.
That was Lena Horne and I've Got a Name. It must have seemed impossible after Evita to have followed it with an equal success, but in fact you did. I mean, you did Cats.
Well, that was pure luck, I have to say. After Evita, I was out of work for over a year. I couldn't get arrested. Just nothing. I was offered every musical that anybody had ever written, which were, as you rightly say, it couldn't better or follow Evita, because that was such a stunning piece. And I just wasn't really offered anything that was worthwhile, so I just sat it out and thought, oh, well, that's it then, you know, here we are, start all over again. And then about, I don't know, well over a year after Evita, Cameron McIntosh rang me up out of the blue and said that Judi Dench had injured herself and would I consider taking over her role in Cats? I mean, it was pure luck. Lucky for me, not so lucky for Judy. And that's how it came about.
And then you followed that, of course, with Chess. And when you look back, you know, as I say, you've been associated with this very significant chapter in the British theatre, which, I mean, Tim and Andrew Lloyd Webber have contributed to greatly. It must be an extraordinary feeling looking back and thinking that you were there at a time when two writers particularly changed the face of musical theatre.
Yes, that's right. I was embarking on my musical career, if you like, around the time that Andrew and Tim were writing Joseph and Jesus Christ Superstar. And, of course, musical theatre has changed very much since that period to date, in that it is a lot of new stuff, anyway, that is being written by Tim or Andrew or whoever, seems to be much more now based on opera in terms that it's nearly all sung, as opposed to the old format, which was you'd have a dialogue scene and then a nice song and then another dialogue scene.
If it were love, I would give that love every second I have. Did I know where he'd lead me to? Did I plan doing all of this for the love of a man? Well, I let it happen anyhow. And what I'm feeling now has no easy explanation. Reason plays no part. Turning around a wordless smile, a touch. One of these days, and it won't be long, he'll know more about me. All my dreams will be understood. No surprise, nothing more to learn from the look in my eyes. Don't you know the time is not my friend? I'll fight it to the end, hoping to keep that best of moments when the passion starts. Heaven help my heart. The day that I find suddenly I've run out of secrets, suddenly I'm not always on his mind. Maybe it's best to love a stranger. Well, that's what I've done. Heaven help my heart. Heaven help my heart.
Another record, please.
Well, this song is from Paul Simon, someone that I've admired over the years since Bridge Over Troubled Water, really, back in the 70s. I just like this song. It's a great album, and I play it all the time in the car, very loudly. And this is one of my favourite tracks from the album. It's called Diamonds on the Soles of Her Shoes.
People say she's crazy, she got diamonds on the soles of her shoes. Well, that's one way to lose these walking blues. Diamonds on the soles of your shoes. She was physically forgotten, but then she slipped into my pocket with my car keys. She said, you've taken me for granted because I please you. Wearing these diamonds. And I could say, ooh, 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 ooh.
talking about, as if everybody here would know exactly what I was talking about. I'm talking about diamonds on the soles of his shoes.
Another ambition of mine is to sing opera, which I'm sure I will never achieve, but singing lessons only, possibly. But this is a wonderful piece of music from Madame Butterfly, and it's the aria One Fine Day, sung by the most wonderful voice ever, Mirella Freni.
Thank you.
That was One Fine Day from Puccini's Mad and Butterfly, sung by Mirella Freni, with the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Herbert von Karajan. You're now on this desert island, records. You have to imagine now that a wave comes along where you're left with one record. Which would you choose to preserve?
Well, I think it's going to have to be the silly time. I think it's going to have to be Here Comes the Sun, because that reminds me of, as I said, a very happy time in my life, so that's the one I've decided to keep.
Now, what about the book? You can assume that you've got the works of Shakespeare and you've got the Bible with you. What else would you take?
Well, I don't know if it's allowed, but I try it on anyway, to take the complete works of Charles Dickens. I've read quite a few of his stories, and they're just such wonderful stories. I love the way he uses language, the way we don't speak today. Also, he writes rather long, thick books, and as I'm a particularly slow reader, I should think that would keep me amused for some time.
So all the works of Dickens in one volume?
Yes,
all
please.
Right, fine. OK, and then the luxury object inanimate.
Yes, well, I've chosen a piano because I've been promising myself for some time now that I will learn to play the piano, and being in the profession that I am and having the lifestyle that I do, there isn't always a lot of time to devote to having piano lessons and, more important, practising. One's always having to rush off here, there and everywhere. So I thought, well, if I was stuck on a desert island, at least I could have all the time in the world to practice the piano without annoying anybody. And I think that equally would keep me amused.
And looking back on this career you've had with so many highs, so many wonderful opening nights and occasions when you've been with a successful show, can you just pick out, is it one moment, one opening night perhaps that you remember above all others?
Well, it has to be Evita, really, because that was so extraordinary. And it was the first time. So that will always remain in my memory as the special night. My father always used to say to me, you know, you'll get there, you just got to, you know, because I was to moan about always being the third or fourth in the auditions and then getting the elbow. And he used to say to me, oh, you'll get there, you've just got to persevere, perseverance furthers and all this. And Evita sort of became a family joke in that I was getting closer and closer, and I said, I'm not going to make it, Dad, I'm just not going to get there. So it meant a great deal for them as well, because they had sort of seen me through all these hard, 12 years prior of struggle. So that's something that will remain in my memory forever, probably, I'm sure.
Running around, trying everything new, never expected it to. Don't cry for me, Argentina. The truth is, I never left you. All through my wild days, my mad existence, I kept my promise. Don't keep your distance. Your distance. Have I said too much? There's nothing more I can think of to say to you. But all you have to do is look at me to know that every word is true.
Elaine Paige, thank you very much indeed.